Welcome back. So you just heard Steve Kerr live. There's Luke Walton talking. It's interesting. Every time I see Luke Walton, I wonder what he must be thinking, just because obviously he's going to be the head coach of the Lakers. So you know that he knows that this could end this week for him.
He's thinking that he needs to enjoy this moment, because it'll be a hell of a long time before he gets there as a head coach if the Lakers keep on the path that they're keeping on.
Tell us more.
No, that says it all. Marc Stein and Mike Wilbon know what I'm talking about.
I love it. Of course, Stephen A. Smith, that's whose voice that you're hearing. How could you mistake it? Mike Wilbon, Marc Stein with me here. We are waiting Steph Curry coming out onto the court.
That cheer,
here he is.
We don't have to turn around.
Right? I thought it was getting a little bit louder in here. You're right. That is, there's Steph. Steph's out there. And Mark, you have recently wrote an article about the possibility of the Warriors winning another championship, but Steph not being the MVP. Tell us more about that perspective.
Yeah, in NBA history, 17 MVPs have gone on to win a championship that same season. Only two have not been also Finals MVP. Kareem Abdul-Jabbar in 1980 and Steph Curry last year. So I want to go to Stephen A. Smith. I want a preview of First Take the day after the Warriors win the mythical championship. If Steph Curry is not the Finals MVP 2 years in a row, what will you be saying that morning?
Not much. The fact is that they've been a dominant team. He was a dominant player on a dominant team, 73-9. I actually had a call on my radio show today, asked me that identical question. And I'll tell you something right now. Game two, for example, why would Steph Curry explode when Draymond Green is left wide open? He's hitting 11 of 20 shots, 5 of 8 from three-point range. He finishes with 28 points. Why would Steph Curry explode when the Golden State Warriors methodically pick you apart, beat you by 10 in the second quarter, 12 in the third quarter? They're up by 30 at some point in the fourth quarter, and you know you got an NBA final series to be looking forward to. Now, if he was this way and they were losing, that would be different.
I think he's in for some heat.
Yeah,
if they win it all again and he's not the Finals MVP.
You think he's going to take heat for it?
I think I'm comfortable. Because this is the culture we live in.
People should be shouted down.
That's right.
Told how stupid they are.
Thank you.
Right?
Totally.
And people are increasingly stupid about these things. First of all, look, I mean, I memorize. I study this stuff like crazy. And I don't have any idea who the MVPs are every year. I can tell you the MVPs are regular season. Finals MVPs, I didn't even know. I would presume that Magic was, because Kareem did miss game six. But so what? I mean, when you look back on the long history of this league, I mean, how many of those, were they awarding that when Russell Celtics were playing, Mark? Were they awarding
1969
that?
1969 was the first year.
Did Russell win it in 69, his final year? We don't even know.
You're right.
It doesn't matter. And if anybody gives Steph Curry heat for that, they should be shouted down.
And called for the idiots that they are.
Really. And
right?
Look,
I'm glad. I want to be wrong.
And part of it is, you know, it's interesting. If we go back a little bit, let's play this game about finals. Yes, Magic had what I think was the greatest game of his career in the finals. He did. I mean, that game in Philadelphia.
Yeah, game six.
But you know what? I don't know, when we look at other great players, the greatest players, that necessarily had a run of them in the finals. They had them sprinkled throughout the playoffs, and then when they got to the finals, the only thing that mattered is winning.
And let's be real here. In game one, he only scored 11 points, but if Cleveland isn't overplaying him the way they do, things don't open up for Sean Livingston.
Right.
In game two, as Steve Kerr just said at the podium, he was going to have a blowout third quarter if not for the foul.
Not only that, let's go back to last year. Andre Iguodala came on, and obviously when you inserted him into the starting lineup, it changed the complexion of the series somewhat. Steph Curry struggled in the first two games. After that, when everybody tried to call him Matthew Dellavedova, some kind of Steph Curry killer, what happened? He got killed, okay? Yeah. So remember that it could have easily been Steph Curry as the Finals MVP. It's just that we didn't ignore the fact that Iguodala stepped into the lineup and had an immediate impact.
I voted for Iguodala with no apologies.
That's
I thought he changed the series.
He did change the series, and I agree with you.
Let me just say this. When you have a great player who doesn't have as much pressure, I say as much, it's the finals. Every game, every moment has its pressure. But you know what? If they're going pretty well and they're not playing to the sweet Georgia Brown music that Golden State often does when they get up, if they're not that lax but just free, this could be the time where you see him have Steph have that kind of game. Up 2-0. You talk about a nail in the coffin game if he comes out and has one of those 35, 38-point games. Well, he just gets on a run and has the Curry flurry, which we've seen a couple times in
the playoffs.
Yep. He doesn't have to do it.
a game in which everyone expects LeBron possibly to have that kind of game because of how miffed, right?
Well, he's desperate. I expect LeBron to me, it's not about his numbers. It's about demanding something from his teammates and getting it.
Leadership.
That's what the greatest players, and LeBron is one of them in the history of this league, the greatest players are able to get that, to extract that thing out of teammates when it seems like they're not going to. You know the clip we always see, a timeout in the Utah Bulls series where Jordan says to Steve Kerr, they're going to double me and I'm coming to you. You know, and it just played out that way, and Kerr hits the shot and they win the game, and you see that sort of thing happen, and they have to. Charles Barkley told us on an earlier segment, guys, that this is the night where there's no pat on the back. It's about a foot lower, and he expects LeBron to have his foot there. That's what he may have to do,
Mike,
to bring the best results out of his team.
You and Mark, I got to tell y'all this story. It's two. Michael Jordan is in an elevator with Scottie Pippen during a playoff game. I know you know this story, Mike Wilbon. And Scottie Pippen is looking at the guys and talking about, bring your A game, bring your A game. And Michael Jordan said, please, man, bring A game. How about that? Bring A game. Up to right. That's one story. So then you got him denigrating you to get the most out of you. You got Kobe in guys behind all over them. He's not liked, getting on them to the point where some of them didn't like him at times, but they gave max effort. We see LeBron having a good time, you know, hugging guys, having a ball, everybody smiling and laughing. You're supposed to be the affable superstar, which means it should be easier for them to like you. But that's not necessarily working when it comes to maximizing the potential around you, is it? So let's keep that in mind. He should be a guy that can get the most out of those other individuals because God knows he's going to need them.
I think it's a gas tank issue with him as much as anything, though. I just think the Warriors are running him ragged. They're playing a team that's much better than anyone they've seen all year. And in the fourth quarter, LeBron's gas. He's fading as these games are going on.
What about leadership?
I mean, look, leadership is huge to me, and I think that's an area that he has to be better. But if he's not at his peak in the fourth quarter, I don't know if leadership's going to make up the difference.
All right, take a look. Turn around because Steph Curry's right over our shoulder here. And when you mentioned leadership, Stein, I think something that's interesting about this team is it's not just him. It's not. It seems like they've got depth of leaders as well, correct?
Well, I just think the Warriors' chemistry is the best in the league. I think they've proven that. I think their pecking order is well established. And the reality is the way this series is playing out, the Cavs are showing us that they've been kind of branded as front runners. When things are going great, they're going to be great. Things have not gone great in the series, and they're not responding to adversity well, and they're showing the cracks.
So can LeBron make those demands tonight? Can he elevate his own play?
He has to, Mike Wilbon.
He has to get me.
Why are you asking that question? See, this is what bothers me about Mike Wilbon right here. Mike Wilbon, let me tell everybody. So Mike Wilbon, columnist extraordinaire for the Washington Post, working for ESPN for years, been around the NBA for about 40 years. Yeah, this man knows the answer to these questions, but he asks us these questions because he wants us to be nice about it. Come on, you know the answer to that question.
He's trying to be inclusive, like Steph Curry,
you know,
right?
I think it's in him. I believe it's in him to do this as we watch Steph Curry, as we can't get enough of Steph Curry warm-ups. And
I can't get enough of warm-ups. I can't get enough of this either.
I'm asking that question because, Stephen, they're down 2-0.
Right.
And if they don't do this and if he doesn't produce, I believe he has it in him, and I believe he'll do it.
I believe he has it in him to perform at an elite level. I believe he has it in him to be the LeBron James that showed up for the most part last year during the NBA Finals. But I believe that LeBron James can bring his A game, and they could still lose.
Have you seen how poorly he and Kyrie Irving are meshing? When you dig into
it's
the
bad.
Numbers, it is gruesome.
Yeah.
Bad is putting it mildly.
And how about on the defensive end alone? You could just paint a picture.
Well, Kyrie's showing the opponent. Golden State is shooting 78% on anybody that Kyrie is defending.
But
78%.
But some of these things we knew in the regular season. Some of these things, I mean, look, I know Mark knew, being around this team every day for the last 3 months, we knew the Warriors were going to attack Kevin Love and Kyrie Irving. They did, and it has worked. Now, will this change in the lineup and I want to see how big they go. You were begging for this last game.
That's right.
He didn't give it to you.
He didn't give it, and they saying
until
that he's
late.
They're saying he's not going to give it to give it to me tonight. Let Tyronn Lue not listen to me. Let him keep ignoring.
I got to go
I'm
do
saying.
Radio. Someone far more knowledgeable
right.
is coming in here.
Stein, there we thank go. You. We're going to welcome man. In Tim Legler. While we That's do that, right. guys, it hasn't all been roses for the Warriors because they have lost four straight game threes.
Okay.
So the streak started here in Cleveland in last year's NBA Finals. What? You want to?
But they've also lost early on their home court in the playoffs. That didn't happen in this
That's final. True. And Curry wasn't available for
There we go.
This is the thing to me on the game threes. This is when they start playing to the sweet Georgia Brown music.
When you
and they
say
have
that,
22 turnovers.
You mean?
They go globetrotter.
Yep.
And it's just not, you
they
know.
They have fun.
They don't play with the urgency. And that's what drives Steve Kerr to go, you know, Green Hornet on some clipboard.
Yes.
And can we see that tonight? I'm interested to hear what Tim has to say about
Hello,
that.
Legs.
We're talking
Hello.
About the Warriors. They seem to get so loosey-goosey, Tim, when they have a lead. Like,
yeah.
And they start playing the sweet Georgia Brown music. And I wonder if that's a possibility that we're looking at tonight.
Could be. I hear all the conversation that's taking place about the Cavaliers, and they need to come and show more fight and more want to and all that stuff. It's a lot more than that. They're in over their heads. That's what it comes down to. This
the
is
Cavs.
A better team. The Warriors are just a better team. They're deeper. They're more balanced. And they have a phenomenal game plan against this team, which basically is we're not going to overreact to LeBron James getting layups against us. We're not going to overreact. A lot of teams do. They start running extra guys, and they trap. And now he's picking you apart, and all these role players become impact players. They're saying, no, it's not going to happen. J.R. Smith, Kevin Love, Channing Frye, none of you got Shumpert. We're not giving you open looks. LeBron, have at it. All the single coverage you want. Get as many layups as you want. We're not going to leave these guys.
They don't double-team him until so late in the
clock. Why, Mike?
They meet him at the rim, but they don't come early. And that's what Atlanta did, and he picked them apart to the tune of 77 made threes.
But, Mike and Tim, here's the deal. Not only are they throwing single coverage at LeBron, they're different looks. So Harrison Barnes will defend against him differently than Andre Iguodala will defend against him, even though Andre Iguodala spends the majority of the time on him when he's in the game. The point is, if you're getting those different looks, even if you could get to the basket, you have to get to the basket differently depending on the defender that's up against you. So that causes a delay. It causes guys to stand around and watch. And these are not guys that need to stand around and watch because they're looking for excuses to take time off anyway. So you got all of that going on. So the way I look at it, Tim is right. They are in over their heads. LeBron can bring forth his A game. They could still lose, but Golden State just has to make sure to remain in attack mode, which I think they will do because I've been saying it all year. They've been telling me since last offseason, they wanted Cleveland. They didn't just want the ring.
Right.
They want this team. They are not going to be lax with this team, in my opinion.
And Steve Kerr said today that they're not surprised necessarily what they've seen from this team in games 1 and 2. Legs, I want to get your thought on what's going on to the Cavs beyond the arc. They're now 5 for 26. On contested threes.
Yeah, they're not getting the same clean looks they got in the first 3 rounds of the playoffs. It's a major, major adjustment. This team fell in love with the three-point shot throughout the course of the playoffs, actually to the point where they gave Toronto 2 games by taking 82 of them in those 2 losses. They relied on the shot so much, and now it's being taken away from them. And this team is forcing them to play a different way. And it's a tough adjustment because the one thing I've noticed, this is an amazing statistic, and I've been saying this last couple of days because it blows me away every time I say it. The Cleveland Cavaliers have 4 assisted field goals in this series, 4 that don't involve Kyrie or LeBron, 4. They're forcing those 2 guys to do everything in terms of offense generation. The Golden State Warriors have 32 baskets, assisted baskets, that don't include Steph or Clay.
Well, that speaks to your point about being overwhelmed and facing a team with so much talent,
balance,
and so many playmakers
depth,
at
so
a time when the
guys,
game is
Mike,
evolving in that direction.
That's exactly
so,
right.
Okay, Tim, what would you do as a counter? What do you want to see from Cleveland? If you were in there right now and you have these decisions to make as a head coach, what do you want to see from the Cavaliers?
All right, to me, the bigger adjustments need to come on the defensive end because, look, you're not going to reinvent your offense overnight. This is how they're playing. They're an ISO-heavy team. They're relying on 2 guys to create offense. They could probably get to the mid-80s, high 80s. They have to figure out a better defensive game plan. To me, they have overloaded their defense to such an extent to worry about Steph Curry catching the basketball that they're breaking down all over the place. It's almost gimmicky with all the switches and the extra defenders and how many times they've made mistakes communicating on that. more straight-up man-to-man hardcore defense. Put somebody on him, and you're on him for the possession. Ride him around and guard him. But we have to start taking away some of these other things, because I don't think that Andre Iguodala, Sean Livingston, Leandro Barbosa, any of those guys feel like they're playing against finals defense. They have so much space.
Well, they played against a tougher defense in the previous round.
No question. They have so much space.
Absolutely.
And they're good basketball
players. Well, the other thing, guys, that we have to remember, as Tim pointed out, the better your defense is, the more rebounds they are to grab. The more rebounds they are to grab, the more you can end up getting in a break. Cleveland's Achilles heel is that once you get into an offense, you're an ISO team. And this team is too elite defensively with too many defenders who can defend multiple positions where you're not going to beat them playing isolation. But if you control the boards and you're able to get out on a break, not only do you get easier baskets, but you elevate their level of confidence, meaning Cleveland, because you don't get them stuck in a rut of having to run an offense that they're going to quickly find out is not going to work against this defense. You're in an open court. It's me and you. Let's go. And they can live with that because that they have that level of confidence in their skill. But when you get in a set offense and you're the Cleveland Cavaliers, you are not equipped to go up against this defense, and they know it.
When you watch this warm-up that we're watching right now, Steph Curry, about halfway into it, what goes through your mind?
Well, it's just amazing, like, the routine that he has. It's different than anybody I've ever seen. Like, I was a guy that was prided myself in my pregame warm-up. I usually took 153-point shots before every single game.
Wow.
I took 30 from each of the five main spots that I would get them, and I was out there before anybody because I hated balls flying around when I was trying to shoot. I wanted to be out there by myself. So I thought my routine was pretty regimented, but he comes out in the different things he does around the basket with the spins and the English and all the stuff he does to get himself acclimated to the basketball before he starts shooting is just so unique. And it fascinates me every time. I've seen him do it so many times, but I just watch him and study him like, what exactly is going through his mind right now? What is he feeling? You know, and eventually he goes on these runs where he shoots these jumpers, and he'll go make 5-6 in a row from half court practically, and everybody gets wowed. It's almost like coming out to watch a home run hitter, right? In a batting practice.
It is.
The guys get out there early to see that.
You know, the funny thing is, I was noticing that during the Oklahoma City series, Tim, and he was going to foul line and just taking one dribble in and shooting those little hooks off glass.
Yeah.
Remember what he did at the end of the quarter? Well, now, he was practicing most of them from the right side, but he did a couple from the left side with the left hand. And then here he has the highlight of that series, probably the one picture we're left with, the one image, is Curry at the end of the quarter going in, putting it high off glass. He did that 7 or 8 times in the warm-up while we're watching it. And you wonder, you know, the ability to transfer that imagination, that imaginative use of a practice session while everything's going on to the game. Overshooting over Kevin Durant, I think, was one of the defenders on that play. 6'11", the wingspan he's got, I can never get enough of this.
And I tell you what's interesting to me, it's fascinating. I'm hoping, I have a feeling he's going to influence a generation of shooters in this country, young American-born basketball players, because it's a different way now to become elite. It used to be, you know, everybody wanted to get to the rim and dunk for a 20-year stretch. That's all kids wanted to do at the AAU level because that's what got the most attention, and you had to be like a freak athlete to do those things. He's proving you don't. He's slightly built. He's 6'4", and just through repetition with handle and shooting, he has done this to himself, and I think there's a wave of players. Now, they might be 10 years from now because they're young,
right?
But now there's another way to become great, and it's just through skill set. It's incredible to me to watch.
To piggyback off of that, covering Allen Iverson, he was a 6-foot guard, 160 pounds soaking wet. But even he didn't have, when you're thinking about Steph Curry, he may not end up having the impact that Steph Curry has. Because with Allen Iverson, despite his size, normal, and what happened, his agility, his athleticism, his speed and quickness for his size was still electrifying.
Yeah.
With Steph Curry, you can be Steph Curry. Go out there and shoot.
Right.
Practice 500 jumps. I'm just talking about in their eyes.
And it's relatable.
My eye, it's relatable. Just go out there and shoot 500 jump shots a day. Practice day and night. Make sure you're in the park in the dark with the only light in the park being a street light across the street. Little dark, focus on the rim and just shoot and follow through all day long.
Well, you know what?
And you can be that in their mind.
Jim Boeheim is here tonight in attendance. And, of course, Jim has been with the U.S., with USA Basketball for years now.
Yeah.
And we were talking about sort of when this metamorphosis took place. And Jim was talking about early in Steph's time with Team USA, they could just move him around. He wasn't strong enough to hold position, get spots on the floor where he wanted. And you would come back every year and you would see this evolution in Curry. And that's what you're speaking to. It's work. There's nothing magical about it. There's no secret. And, of course, and Jim says, I mean, Jim Brown's been around basketball 50 years, and he says he's never seen shooting like this. We talked to Charles Barkley earlier, and Charles said, no, never. And he played with and against some of the great shooters in the history of the league. Never have they seen anything like this. And so it's just...
Where does he get that, do you think? I mean, is that an influence of his father?
No question.
It started there.
And by the way, nobody has mentioned this that I've heard. We've talked about the greatness of Steph Curry. We've talked about the greatness of LeBron and other players. We've talked about the dichotomy that exists between the two teams. You know, one of the things that has gone virtually unnoticed as far as I'm concerned throughout this NBA Finals? There are two guys whose fathers played in the league. They were around their fathers watching the game, not just their daddy, but the game, and learning it firsthand and watching an evolution take place. They know what these moments are like. You're talking about Michael Thompson, the father of Klay Thompson, and Del Curry, the father of Steph Curry. These guys have been around the game all their lives because of their daddies. So the moment doesn't faze them. It doesn't shake them at all. Nobody else on either team can say they have that experience, to my knowledge. Nobody's brought that up.
I unfortunately had the misfortune of guarding Del Curry a lot.
Yes.
And he was one of those guys that was relentless because you could never relax. I mean, I remember specifically Del Curry coming off of screen, and I was inside of his jersey when he caught the ball, and he shot it before I knew he had it. And then I turn and look, and it's going through the net, and you're just looking at the bench like, what am I supposed to do about that? So Steph Curry learned how to, he had a perfect stroke at age 6 because his father had a perfect stroke. So there's no question that influenced him. He started really young, perfecting his shooting form. But there's a whole nother level of depth perception and an innate sense of shot making that he has that you just can't acquire, right? Some of that you are born with. The rest of it is just repetition and outworking everybody. And to me, you know, for a guy that I made my living shooting the basketball, I consider myself a guy that did it at a high level. To marvel at another guy that does that to the extent that Steph does, I never thought I'd ever say that about somebody. But it's like, well, okay, I guess I got to give it to him. You know, shooters, they can beat anybody in shooting.
Right.
But he asked me at that one, I'm like, I don't know about that, man. Right. You know, he's on that level where you're just like, I can't relate to Klay.
Let's go there defensively for a second, because I thought the shots that he and Klay made, while they didn't go crazy that entire Oklahoma City series.
No.
But when they did, Tim, I thought the process you described, somebody is in your jersey, you catch, especially Klay when he was shooting over Durant, I thought those shots demoralized Oklahoma City. Is that the feeling when you think you played textbook defense the way you were taught and you can't stop him? Is that what happens?
Absolutely. And all you have to do is go back and watch some of those. And I've been watching it now for 2 years. Watch the reaction of the defender when he turns and looks and the shoulders drop. It is deflating and demoralizing because you played almost perfect defense, particularly the performance of Klay Thompson out of game 6. I mean, some of the shots he was taking, 28, 30 feet on the break off one pass with a guy in your face, like it was nothing, like it's a layup drill.
Right.
It's incredible, like the barrages that they hit you with. I always said this as a player, I would much rather guard a guy that was an electrifying scorer, but was more of a one-on-one type of player, because you definitely were going to get a lot of help in those situations on the drive. These guys, it's all on you. If you get there late, you get your feelings hurt.
And one of the things I religiously have said to so many people is this. Golden State's defense is potent in and of itself.
Yes.
But what makes them even more potent is that whether it's Klay or Steph, they're such elite marksmen that they literally petrify you. And I use the analogy, and people laugh at me until I give them this. I said, if you're in the park, Mike, Lindsey, Tim, you got to wait for next if you lose. There's a long line of people. This is back in the younger days, right? All of a sudden, what happens? You're going to get tight, and you got this guy who is a marksman who will not miss. It makes you, when you're on offense, tight. It makes you worried. Man, I can't mess up. I can't make any mistakes, because if I do it, this dude is going to make me pay.
And that's going to be the Cavaliers tonight. Stephen A. Smith, Mike Wilbon, Tim Legler, great to have you here to join the conversation. Thank you guys so much for being here. Amon Shumpert on the court. The question is he going to get more time on Curry? He's been matched up against Curry on defense 13 times. Curry has not scored a single time. Interesting that we were just talking about that. And, of course, Andre Iguodala, I mean, what can you say about him and the work that he has done to contain LeBron James. We will have much more on SportsCenter right after this on the road in Cleveland.
Dollar with no apologies. That's thought he changed the series.
He did change the series, and I agree with you.
Let me just say this. When you have a great player who doesn't have as much pressure, I say as much, it's the finals. Every game, every moment has its pressure. But you know what? If they're going pretty well and they're not playing to the sweet Georgia Brown music that Golden State often does when they get up, if they're not that lax but just free, this could be the time where you see him have Steph have that kind of game. Up 2-0. You talk about a nail in the coffin game if he comes out and has one of those 35, 38-point games where he just gets on a run and has the Curry flurry, which we've seen a couple times
Curry
in the playoffs.
Curry flurry, yeah.
That he doesn't have to do it.
A game in which everyone expects LeBron possibly to have that kind of game because of how right?
He's desperate.
I expect LeBron, to me, it's not about his numbers. It's about demanding something from his teammates and getting it.
Leadership.
That's what the greatest players, and LeBron is one of them in the history of this league, the greatest players are able to get that, to extract that thing out of teammates when it seems like they're not going to. You know the clip we always see of a timeout in the Utah Bulls series where Jordan says to Steve Kerr, they're going to double me and I'm coming to you. You know, and it just played out that way, and Kerr hits the shot and they win the game, and you see that sort of thing happen. And they have to, Charles Barkley told us on an earlier segment, guys, that this is the night where there's no pat on the back. It's about a foot lower and he expects LeBron to have his foot there. That's what he may have to do,
Mike,
to bring the best results out of his team.
You and Mark, I got to tell y'all this story. It's two. Michael Jordan is in an elevator with Scottie Pippen during a playoff game. I know you know this story, Mike Wilbon. And Scottie Pippen is looking at the guys and talking about, bring your A game, bring your A game. And Michael Jordan said, please, man, bring A game. How about that? Bring A game. Up the right. That's one story. So then you got him denigrating you to get the most out of you. You got Kobe in God behind all over them. He's not like getting on them to the point where some of them didn't like him at times, but they gave max effort. We see LeBron having a good time, you know, hugging guys, having a ball, everybody smiling and laughing. You're supposed to be the affable superstar, which means it should be easier for them to like you. But that's not necessarily working when it comes to maximizing the potential around you, is it? So let's keep that in mind. He should be a guy that can get the most out of those other individuals because God knows he's going to need them.
I think it's a gas tank issue with him as much as anything, though. I just think the Warriors are running him ragged. They're playing a team that's much better than anyone they've seen all year. And in the fourth quarter, LeBron's gassed. He's fading as these games are going on.
What about leadership?
I mean, look, leadership is huge to me, and I think that's an area that he has to be better. But if he's not at his peak in the fourth quarter, I don't know if leadership's going to make up the difference.
All right, take a look, turn around, because Steph Curry's, he's right over our shoulder here. And when you mentioned leadership, Stein, I think something that's interesting about this team is it's not just him. It's not. It seems like they've got depth of leaders as well, correct?
Well, I just think the Warriors' chemistry is the best in the league. I think they've proven that. I think their pecking order is well established. And the reality is the way this series is playing out, the Cavs are showing us that they've been kind of branded as front runners. When things are going great, they're going to be great. Things have not gone great in the series, and they're not responding to adversity well, and they're showing the cracks.
So can LeBron make those demands tonight? Can he elevate his own play?
He has to, Mike Wilbon.
He has to get me.
Why are you asking that question? See, this is what bothers me about Mike Wilbon right here. Mike Wilbon, let me tell everybody. So Mike Wilbon, columnist extraordinaire for the Washington Post, working for ESPN for years, been around the NBA for about 40 years. Yeah, this man knows the answers to these questions, but he asks us these questions because he wants us to be nice about it. Come on, you know the answer to that question.
He's trying to be inclusive, like Steph Curry,
you know,
right?
I think it's in him. I believe it's in him to do this as we watch Steph Curry, as we can't get enough.
Welcome back. So you just heard Steve Kerr live. There's Luke Walton talking. It's interesting. Every time I see Luke Walton, I wonder what he must be thinking, just because obviously he's going to be the head coach of the Lakers. So you know that he knows that this could end this week for him.
He's thinking that he needs to enjoy this moment because it'll be a hell of a long time before he gets there as a head coach if the Lakers keep on the path that they're keeping on.
Tell us. us. Tell us more.
No, that says it all. Marc Stein and Mike Wilbon know what I'm talking about.
I love it. Of course, Stephen A. Smith, that's whose voice that you're hearing. How could you mistake it? Mike Wilbon, Marc Stein with me here. We are waiting Steph Curry coming out onto the court.
That cheer,
here he is.
We don't have to turn around.
Right? I thought it was getting a little bit louder in here. You're right. That is, there's Steph. Steph's out there. And Mark, you have recently wrote an article about the possibility of the Warriors winning another championship, but Steph not being the MVP. Tell us more about that perspective.
Yeah, in NBA history, 17 MVPs have gone on to win a championship that same season. Only two have not been also Finals MVP, Kareem Abdul-Jabbar in 1980 and Steph Curry last year. So I want to go to Stephen A. Smith. I want a preview of First Take the day after the Warriors win the mythical championship. If Steph Curry is not the Finals MVP 2 years in a row, what will you be saying that morning?
Not much. The fact is that they've been a dominant team. He was a dominant player on a dominant team, 73-9. I actually had a call on my radio show today, asked me that identical question. And I tell you something right now. Game two, for example, why would Steph Curry explode when Draymond Green is left wide open? He's hitting 11 of 20 shots, 5 of 8 from three-point range. He finishes with 28 points. Why would Steph Curry explode when the Golden State Warriors methodically pick you apart, beat you by 10 in the second quarter, 12 in the third quarter? They're up by 30 at some point in the fourth quarter, and you know you got an NBA final series to be looking forward to. Now, if he was this way and they were losing, that would be different.
I think he's in for some heat.
Yeah,
if they win it all again and he's not the Finals MVP.
You think he's going to take heat for it?
I think
why?
I'm comfortable. Because I just... Because this is the culture we live in. This is the culture we live in.
People should be shouted down.
That's right.
Told how stupid they are.
Thank you.
Right?
Totally.
And people are increasingly stupid about these things. First of all, look, I mean, I memorize. I study this stuff like crazy. And I don't have any idea who the MVPs are every year. In the I can tell you the MVPs are regular season. Finals MVPs, I didn't even know. I would presume that Magic was, because Kareem did miss game six. But so what? I mean, when you look back on the long history of this league, I mean, how many of those, were they awarding that when Russell Celtics were playing, Mark? Were they awarding
1969
that?
1969
was the first year. Did Russell win it in 69, his final year? We don't even know.
You're right. It doesn't matter.
It doesn't matter. And if anybody gives Steph Curry heat for that, they should be shouted down.
And called for the idiots that they are.
Really. And
right?
Look,
I'm glad. I want to be wrong.
And part of it is, you know, it's interesting. If we go back a little bit, let's play this game about finals. Yes, Magic had what I think was the greatest game of his career in the finals. He did. I mean, that game in Philadelphia.
Yeah, game six.
But you know what? I don't know, when we look at other great players, the greatest players, they necessarily had a run of them in the finals. They had them sprinkled throughout the playoffs, and then when they got to the finals, the only thing that mattered is winning.
And let's be real here. In game one, he only scored 11 points, but if Cleveland isn't overplaying him the way they do, things don't open up for Sean Livingston.
Right.
In game two, as Steve Kerr just said at the podium, he was going to have a blowout third quarter if not for the foul.
Not only that, let's go back to last year. Andre Iguodala came on, and obviously when you inserted him into the starting lineup, it changed the complexion of the series somewhat. Steph Curry struggled in the first two games. After that, when everybody tried to call him Matthew Dellavedova, some kind of Steph Curry killer, what happened? He got killed, okay? Yeah. So remember that it could have easily been Steph Curry as the Finals MVP. It's just that we didn't ignore the fact that Iguodala stepped into the lineup and had an immediate impact.
I voted for Iguodala.
And you wonder how, you know, the ability to transfer that imagination, that imaginative use of a practice session while everything's going on to the game. Overshooting over Kevin Durant, I think, was one of the defenders on that play. And 6'11", and the wingspan he's got, I could never get enough of this.
And I tell you what's interesting to me, it's fascinating. I'm hoping, I have a feeling he's going to influence a generation of shooters in this country, young American-born basketball players, because it's a different way now to become elite. It used to be, you know, everybody wanted to get to the rim and dunk for a 20-year stretch. That's all kids wanted to do at the AAU level, because that's what got the most attention, and you had to be like a freak athlete to do those things. He's proving you don't. He's slightly built. He's 6'4", and just through repetition with handle and shooting, he has done this to himself, and I think there's a wave of players. Now, they might be 10 years from now because they're young,
right?
But now there's another way to become great, and it's just through skill set. It's incredible to me to watch.
To piggyback off of that, covering Allen Iverson, here was a 6-foot guard 160 pounds soaking wet. But even he didn't have, when you're thinking about Steph Curry, he may not end up having the impact that Steph Curry has. Because with Allen Iverson, despite his size, normal, and then what happened, his agility, his athleticism, his speed and quickness for his side was still electrifying. With Steph Curry, you can be Steph Curry. Go out there and shoot.
Right.
Practice 500 jumps. I'm just talking about in their eyes.
And it's relatable.
The eye, it's relatable. Just go out there and shoot 500 jump shots a day. Practice day and night. Make sure you're in the park in the dark with the only light in the park being a street light across the street. Little dark, focus on the rim, and just shoot and follow through all day long.
Well, you know what?
And you can be that in their mind.
Jim Boeheim is here tonight in attendance. And, of course, Jim has been with the U.S., with USA Basketball
yes.
for years now.
Yeah.
And we were talking about sort of when this metamorphosis took place. And Jim was talking about early in Steph's time with Team USA, they could just move him around. He wasn't strong enough to hold position, get spots on the floor where he wanted. And you would come back every year, and you would see this evolution in Curry. And that's what you're speaking to. It's work. There's nothing magical about it. There's no secret. And, of course, and Jim says, I mean, Jim Boeheim's been around basketball 50 years. And he says he's never seen shooting like this. We talked to Charles Barkley yep. earlier, and Charles said, no, never. And he played with and against some of the great shooters in the history of the league. Never have they seen anything like this. And so it's just,
Where does he get that, do you think? I mean, is that an influence of his father?
No
is
question.
It started
and
there.
And by the way, nobody has mentioned this that I've heard. We've talked about the greatness of Steph Curry. We've talked about the greatness of LeBron and other players. We've talked about the dichotomy that exists between the two teams. You know, one of the things that has gone virtually unnoticed as far as I'm concerned throughout this NBA Finals? There are two guys whose fathers played in the league. They were around their fathers watching the game, not just their daddy, but the game, and learning it firsthand and watching an evolution take place. They know what these moments are like. You're talking about Michael Thompson, the father of Klay Thompson, and Del Curry, the father of Steph Curry. These guys have been around the game all their lives because of their daddies. So the moment doesn't faze them. It doesn't shake them at all. Nobody else on either team can say they have that experience, to my knowledge. Nobody's brought that up.
I, unfortunately, had the misfortune of guarding Del Curry a lot.
Yes.
And he was one of those guys that was relentless because you could never relax. I mean, I remember specifically Del Curry coming off of screen, and I was inside of his jersey when he caught the ball, and he shot it before I knew he had it. And then I turn and look, and it's going through the net, and you're just looking at the bench like, what am I supposed to do about that? So Steph Curry learned how to, he had a perfect stroke at age 6 because his father had a perfect stroke. So there's no question that influenced him. He started really young, perfecting his shooting form.
Of Steph Curry warm-ups. And
I can't get enough of warm-ups. I can't get enough of the
game. I can't get enough of this either.
I can't get enough of the game.
I'm asking that question because, Stephen, they're down 2-0.
Right.
And if they don't do this, and if he doesn't produce, I believe he has it in him, and I believe he'll do it.
I believe he has it in him to perform at an elite level. I believe he has it in him to be the LeBron James that showed up for the most part last year during the NBA Finals. But I believe that LeBron James can bring his A game, and they could still lose.
Have you seen how poorly he and Kyrie Irving are meshing? When you dig into the numbers, it is gruesome.
Yeah.
Bad is putting it mildly.
And how about on the defensive end alone? You could just paint a picture.
Well, Kyrie's showing the opponent. Golden State is shooting 78% that Kyrie is defending.
But
78%.
But some of these things we knew in the regular season. Some of these things, I mean, look, we knew. I know Mark knew, being around this team every day for the last 3 months. We knew the Warriors were going to attack Kevin Love and Kyrie Irving. They did, and it has worked. Now, will this change in the lineup? And I want to see how big they go. You were begging for this last game.
That's right.
He didn't give it to you.
He didn't give it. And they're saying
until
that he's
late.
Not gonna, listen, they're saying he's not going to give it to give it to me tonight. Let Tyronn Lue not listen to me. Let him keep ignoring
I gotta
what
go
I'm
do
saying.
Radio. Someone far
right.
more knowledgeable
right.
is coming in here.
Stein,
here
we thank
go.
You. We're going to welcome
man.
In Tim Legler. While we
That's
do that,
right.
guys, it hasn't all been roses for the Warriors because they have lost 4 straight game 3s.
Okay.
So the streak started here in Cleveland in last year's NBA Finals. What? You want to?
But they've also lost early on their home court in the playoffs. That didn't happen in this
That's
final.
True. And Curry wasn't available for
There we
game.
Go.
This is the thing to me on the game 3s. This is when they start playing to the sweet Georgia Brown music.
When you
and they
say
have
that,
22 turnovers.
You mean
they go globetrotter.
Yep.
And it's just not, they don't play with the urgency. And that's what drives Steve Kerr to go, you know, Green Hornet on some clipboard. Yeah. And can we see that tonight? I'm interested to hear what Tim has to say about
Hello,
that.
Legs.
We're talking about the Warriors. They seem to get so loosey-goosey, Tim, when they have a lead, and they start playing the sweet Georgia Brown music, and I wonder if that's a possibility that we're looking at tonight.
Could be. I hear all the conversation that's taking place about the Cavaliers, and they need to come and show more fight and more want to and all that stuff. It's a lot more than that. They're in over their heads. That's what it comes down to. This is a better team. The Warriors are just a better team. They're deeper. They're more balanced. And they have a phenomenal game plan against this team, which basically is, we're not going to overreact to LeBron James getting layups against us. We're not going to overreact. A lot of teams do. They start running extra guys, and they trap. And now he's picking you apart, and all these role players become impact players. They're saying, no, it's not going to happen. J.R. Smith, Kevin Love, Channy Frye, none of you guys. Shumpert, we're not giving you open looks. LeBron, have at it. All the single coverage you want. Get as many layups as you want. We're not going to leave these guys.
They don't double team him until so late in the clock.
Why, Mike?
They meet him at the rim, but they don't come early. And that's what Atlanta did, and he picked them apart to the tune of 77 made threes.
But Mike and Tim, here's the deal. Not only are they throwing single coverage at LeBron, they're different looks. So Harrison Barnes will defend against him differently than Andre Iguodala will defend against him, even though Andre Iguodala spends the majority of the time on him when he's in the game. The point is, if you're getting those different looks, even if you could get to the basket, you have to get to the basket differently depending on the defender that's up against you. So that causes a delay. It causes guys to stand around and watch. And these are not guys that need to stand around and watch because they're looking for excuses to take time off anyway. So you got all of that going on. So the way I look at it, Tim is right. They are in over their heads. LeBron can bring forth his A game. They could still lose, but Golden State just has to make sure to remain in attack mode, which I think they will do because I've been saying it all year. They've been telling me since last offseason, they wanted Cleveland. They didn't just want the ring.
Right.
They want this team. They are not going to be lax with this team, in my opinion.
And Steve Kerr said today that they're not surprised necessarily what they've seen from this team in games 1 and 2. Legs, I want to get your thought on what's going on to the Cavs beyond the arc. They're now 5 for 26 on contested threes.
Yeah, they're not getting the same clean looks they got in the first 3 rounds of the playoffs. It's a major, major adjustment. This team fell in love with the three-point shot throughout the course of the playoffs. Actually to the point where they gave Toronto 2 games by taking 82 of them in those 2 losses. They relied on the shot so much, and now it's being taken away from them. And this team is forcing them to play a different way. And it's a tough adjustment because the one thing I've noticed, this is an amazing statistic, and I've been saying this last couple of days because it blows me away every time I say it. The Cleveland Cavaliers have 4 assisted field goals in this series, 4 that don't involve Kyrie or LeBron, 4. They're forcing those 2 guys to do everything in terms of offense generation. The Golden State Warriors have 32 baskets, assisted baskets, that don't include Steph or Clay.
That speaks to your point about being overwhelmed and facing a team with so much talent,
balance,
and so many playmakers
depth,
at a
so
time when the
guys,
game is evolving in that direction.
That's exactly
so,
right.
Okay, Tim, what would you do as a counter? What do you want to see from Cleveland? If you were in there right now and you have these decisions to make as a head coach, what do you want to see from the Cavaliers?
All right, here to me, the bigger adjustments need to come on the defensive end. Because, look, you're not going to reinvent your offense overnight. This is how they're playing. They're an ISO-heavy team. They're relying on 2 guys to create offense. They can probably get to the mid-80s, high 80s. They have to figure out a better defensive game plan. To me, they have overloaded their defense to such an extent to worry about Steph Curry catching the basketball that they're breaking down all over the place. It's almost gimmicky with all the switches and the extra defenders and how many times they've made mistakes communicating on that. More straight-up man-to-man hardcore defense. Put somebody on him, and you're on him for the possession. Ride him around and guard him. But we have to start taking away some of these other things because I don't think that Andre Iguodala, Sean Livingston, Leandro Barbosa, any of those guys feel like they're playing against finals defense. They have so much space.
Well, they played against a tougher defense in the previous round.
No question. They have so much space.
Absolutely.
And they're good basketball players.
Well, the other thing, guys, that we have to remember, as Tim pointed out, the better your defense is, the more rebounds they are to grab. The more rebounds there are to grab, the more you can end up getting in a break. Cleveland's Achilles heel is that once you get into an offense, you're an ISO team. And this team is too elite defensively with too many defenders who can defend multiple positions where you're not going to beat them playing isolation. But if you control the boards and you're able to get out on a break, not only do you get easier baskets, but you elevate their level of confidence, meaning Cleveland, because you don't get them stuck in a rut of having to run an offense that they're going to quickly find out is not going to work against this defense. You're in an open court. It's me and you. Let's go. And they can live with that because that they have that level of confidence in their skill. But when you get in a set offense and you're the Cleveland Cavaliers, you are not equipped to go up against this defense, and they know it.
When you watch this warm-up that we're watching right now, Steph Curry, about halfway into it, what goes through your mind?
Well, it's just amazing, like, the routine that he has. It's different than anybody I've ever seen. Like, I was a guy that was prided myself in my pregame warm-up. I usually took 153-point shots before every single game.
Wow.
I took 30 from each of the five main spots that I would get them, and I was out there before anybody because I hated balls flying around when I was trying to shoot. I wanted to be out there by myself. So I thought my routine was pretty regimented, but he comes out in the different things he does around the basket with the spins and the English and all the stuff he does to get himself acclimated to the basketball before he starts shooting. It's just so unique, and it fascinates me every time. I've seen him do it so many times, but I just watch him study him like, what exactly is going through his mind right now? What is he feeling? You know, and eventually he goes on these runs where he shoots these jumpers, and he'll go make 5-6 in a row from half court practically, and everybody gets wowed. It's almost like coming out to watch a home run hitter, right? In a batting practice.
It is.
Guys get out there early to see that.
We know the funny thing is, I was noticing that during the Oklahoma City series, Tim, and he was going to foul line and just taking one dribble in and shooting those little hooks off glass.
Yeah.
Remember what he did at the end of the quarter? Well, now, he was practicing most of them from the right side, but he did a couple from the left side with the left hand. And then here he has the highlight of that series, probably the one picture we're left with, the one image, is Curry at the end of the quarter going in, putting it high off glass. He did that 7 or 8 times in the warm-up while we're watching.